Francis, thanks for joining us today. We're glad you could be with us.
My pleasure.
Can you tell us first a little bit about the center? Tell us how that got started and what it's about.
The Greenberger Center for Social and Criminal Justice is really something that got born out of my own exposure to the criminal justice system in the U.S. Because I have a mentally ill son who committed some illegal behaviors, and as a result was arrested and eventually incarcerated. So through that, I began to see what was going on in the system, and things didn't seem quite right. And I decided to go beyond my son's issues and investigate and try to learn about this world that until then, like many Americans, you know, was something I was completely distanced from. Mm-hmm. And what I discovered, I went on a listening tour and I met with people who were senior people who'd been part of the administration of the American justice system, and I met with people all the way down the pole to people who were incarcerated. And the interesting thing was that uniformly, the people on top who often will want to protect their institutions, they were all saying, this isn't working. Wow. Something is very wrong. And that's when I realized that my instincts had been right, and I got more and more involved. And the Greenberger Center is an attempt to advocate for things that we believe need to be changed. And it's also part of its mission is to create an alternative to incarceration for mentally ill people in the United States. So that's like a very specific program, but very important, because half of all people incarcerated in the United States today are mentally ill.
And that's an incredible revelation. I don't know if a lot of people understand that, but it's not just about drugs anymore. This is about those who have really never been treated for mental illness, and they will often offend again and again because there's not a rehabilitation setting in incarceration, right? So they leave and often are the people who will easily reoffend, right?
Well, like the whole history of mass incarceration in the United States, it's curious when you really start reviewing what happened. Basically, in the 1950s, many of America's mental hospitals were not functioning on a high level. And as a result, we started something called the deinstitutionalization movement, which was essentially to let people out of the mental hospitals into the communities and try to treat them there, also using pharmacological drugs. But that had a limited amount of success. Works 50, 60% of the time, but that leaves a lot of people that it doesn't work for.
Sure.
In the 1950s, we had 550,000 mental health beds in the United States. Populations doubled, so today you'd expect there to be 1.1 million. We have 35,000, 3%. We closed 95% of the mental hospitals that we had at the time. And if you look at compare the number of beds we don't have with the number of mentally ill people incarcerated, it turns out to be exactly the same number.
Wow.
We're short 1,065,000 beds. We have approximately 1.1 million mentally ill people in jail. We took them out of the hospitals. We thought we had a community-based system for them. So many people succeeded, but many people failed. And those are the people that are in jail. And the drugs are often a coexisting condition for people with mental illness.
Mm-hmm.
People who are experiencing the pain of mental illness, and it is painful, often turn to drugs as a kind of self-medication, a way to deal with their issues.
Mm-hmm. What about some of the things you're advocating for? I was saying to you before we started that I was reading this list, and I wasn't sure if it was written by you or by the Holy Father, because a lot of what Pope Francis has been speaking about and writing about are so many things that your center is really all about helping people to get beyond incarceration by preparing them for life back in the community, about letting go of solitary confinement. There's a lot of things. Maybe you can give us some more insight into that.
Sure. The problem is multifaceted. But let's start with the one you mentioned, the issue of returning people to life outside of prison. In other countries, take Germany as an example, the entire system of incarceration is based out of, around, rehabilitating people so that when they leave, they don't reoffend. Mm-hmm. In America, that's a very low priority for us. Essentially, our approach is punitive. You did something wrong to me, to society, we're going to punish you. And we hope that by punishing you, that somehow that's going to convince you not to do it again. And it turns out that that doesn't work. Two-thirds of people who have been incarcerated recidivize and go back to jail. That's not only wasteful of human life, it's also very expensive. So we have to find a better way. And there are examples in the world of better ways. Germany, for instance, is a good one. We know that America incarcerates 7 times as many people as the rest of the world. So we're doing something very different. And people have studied. Jeremy Tarcher, who's the president of John Jay, one of our most important criminal justice universities in New York, led a very important study group. And they tried to figure out, how did this happen and what happened? One of the findings that he came up with, astonishingly, is that America doesn't have more criminals than other places. We have longer sentences. And that's why we have more people in jail, which is a remarkable outcome of his study. And when you really look at how long our sentences are, they're draconian compared to other places around the world. And there are certain standards that are supposed to be used when you figure out how long sentences are. And these standards are not followed by our system. People in America seem to be, or at least it was political, seem politically, what the political system thought was that people wanted retribution. They wanted a punitive response. Mm-hmm. And during Ronald Reagan's administration, he ran on law and order. When he got elected, there were 300,000 people incarcerated. In 8 years, when he left, there were 1.5 million. Ronald Reagan delivered on his promise, increased incarceration 500%.
That kind of says it, I mean, in many ways. I want to also mention outreach to families of those who are incarcerated, because that's part of what you do. That's a very difficult thing for families. Often their loved ones are in a jail that is very far away. It's impossible to visit. That has an effect on a prisoner. It also has an effect on a family and on the family setting and on the children. What about that situation?
Well, of course, I think the single most important thing in preparing people who are incarcerated to return to life to normal life is to motivate them. And what better motivation is there for people than a connection with their family? Mm-hmm. And if we think about the children of incarcerated people, we know that children have a need to be connected with their parents when at all possible. So it's interesting that when you go to visit Rikers Island or any prison, certainly when you go to Rikers, 95% of the visitors are women and children going to visit their husbands, fathers, or their children. And you see these little kids coming to prison, and what is that experience like? Yeah. And how does that inform their development? And we know that there's a higher incidence of of incarceration by children of incarcerated people. It was interesting, the Osborne Society, which is a wonderful organization in New York that has its principal mission helping families of incarcerated people. They fought long and hard to get a play area put into the visiting rooms of prisons.
Wow.
Before that, you know, the child would come and, you know, sit at a little metal table in uncomfortable chairs and have his visit with his parents. There was no way that the parent could interact in a normal way that you would with a child. Osborne has been successful, I don't know whether at Rikers, but in two or three of the upstate prisons of, they now have an area where you can go and can interact with your child, and they have some children's toys and games and the kind of thing that permits communication with young children.
And you wouldn't think that was extraordinary, would you?
Right, you wouldn't think it was extraordinary.
No.
I mean, I remember talking with Liz Glazer, who runs Osborne. You know, she had to campaign for a long, long time to get this simple concession. And Osborne was paying for everything. There wasn't anything that the prisons were being asked to pay for, but just to get permission for what would seem like nothing was a big deal.
I told you earlier that Pope Francis is going to have a world day for those who are imprisoned. He's going to have some prisoners are coming to the Vatican, actually. They're being released from all over the world to come to have Mass with him and to be blessed by him. And he's calling on every nation in the world to provide this coverage live so that he can speak to prisoners. And he's asking all prisons to also open their doors so that we can bring this message to those who are incarcerated, which we're lucky enough to be doing in many of the prisons in our area right now. They've been very generous in that. But even the idea of having hope and faith in a prison is something that's relatively new. It connects with what you were saying just about some things we would just assume, like a place for young kids to be able to be young kids, but also a place for men and women to be able to connect with their God or connect with their faith in some level or have a sense of hope. That's not common everywhere, right? That just, I mean, thanks be to God, the Pope is moving this a little bit, but it's not happening everywhere.
Well, Pope Francis is an incredible inspiration to all of us, Catholics and non-Catholics. And he carries many, many important messages that resonate on many different levels. And you know, one of the things that has to happen to bring the underclasses up is they have to hope and believe, not only in faith, but in the system.
Sure.
And when you have an economic system that deprives them of the ability to make a fair living, obviously they're not going to be a great advocate for the system. And globalization is a fact of life today, and many people are left behind because of it, particularly people who are not college educated. So we have to give hope to these people, because a lot of crime comes out of poorer, underprivileged neighborhoods and groups of people. If the criminal justice system is unfair, that's another reason that, because that's where these people are connecting with government, that also alienates them. And as we know from our political situation in America today, there's a very large group of alienated people who've just lost faith in our government. We have to come back and understand that we have a responsibility to help others, partially out of self-interest, because you can't have a happy middle-class life if people are so despairing around you that they're not going to be part of the community in a positive way. And we see it. We see you know, people joining gangs. We see incredible violence. You know, certain places, Baltimore has 10 times the murder rate of New York City with 1/10 the population. You know, I have a national real estate business, so I see what goes on in a lot of parts of the country. It's frightening. So we have to find a way to give hope back to these people so they stay within our system and see a possibility to rise up. And I think that's part of what Pope Francis is conveying, that we have to give hope to the poor and to the disadvantaged.
And I guess that's part of that spiral downward that we read about, we hear about in society, that there's a sort of spiral downward. How do we stop it? And how do we even begin to push back? But it's honestly, I'm not throwing bouquets. It's people like you that are doing this. You know, if more people said, I can make a difference here, I can make a difference in some way in my community, I can volunteer and go to a jail and be a visitor for someone who doesn't have a visitor, I can be a pen pal. All these small efforts and large efforts begin to turn that spiral around, don't you think?
Absolutely. And I think it's there are rewards also for the person who's doing that. It's not all charity. Mm-hmm. You know, when you help other people, you feel better.
Sure.
You feel better. It's certainly something that I think everyone should be happy to participate in. And as a group, we're going to make a big, big difference. Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you so much for your time. And I want to come back and speak to you another time because I know you do so many wonderful things. I know your after school program, I've read about that, and I'm excited to talk to you about that some other time. But
I'd be very happy to.
You're a legendary person. It's an honor to be with you. So thanks so much.
Thank you so much.